Hello, I'm Pastor Woodson Moore, Senior Pastor of Fairton Christian Center, and I want to invite you to something very new, very special that we're doing here at the church. We have implemented every other Sunday a healing room where people can come and a group of individuals from the church that have been trained and schooled in praying for the sick will pray for you individually and lift up your situation before the Lord. Years ago, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, go tell my people Jesus wants them well. The Bible, scripture after scripture, confirms this. It is the will of God that you be well, and we want to take our energy, strength, and spiritual belief and couple it with yours and see you get well. So we are inviting you to our healing rooms at Fairton Christian Center. Appreciate all of you being here, and I hope you have a wonderful day tomorrow with your families and friends, celebrating labor, celebrating work and the workers. Jesus, we just ask that you would anoint this word now, be a strength to our heart and life, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. Well, thinking about Labor Day and work and thinking about our nation, thinking about our economy and all the different things that we are facing, and I thought about when I was right out of college, I took a teaching position, public school in Willard, Missouri, and I was the ninth grade basketball coach. Now, I played 4 years of college basketball, and we had, when you get to the college level, everybody you're playing with, they're good, okay? And so we worked every day on fundamentals. We worked on dribbling and passing, but we spent an awful lot of time running plays. So when I began to coach, that's what I began to teach these ninth graders, was plays. And I made a big mistake because they were not college basketball players. They were ninth grade basketball players. And they could run these plays flawlessly. The problem was they couldn't get the ball from where they took it out of bound up to the other end of the court where they could run the play, because the other teams would slap a press on them and they couldn't dribble well, they couldn't pass well. So we won our first game, and that was the last game we won the whole year. All because the coach did not take the time to work diligently on fundamentals. We lost because we were not fundamentally sound, which brings us to our own personal lives. See, there are fundamental principles that make you good at anything. I remember I was in basic training. It was January. It was so cold, and we were out at the rifle range, and they had us shoot in pairs. And there, my buddy was a little Afro-American soldier, and what they do is if you were shooting from the prone position, they have you down, and then your buddy would be prone this way, looking you right in the eye to make sure you didn't flinch when you pulled the trigger, you know. And it was so cold, his nose was running, my nose was running. We had trigger mittens, which are really wool mittens with a trigger finger, and the mittens were full from where we'd wiped our nose. It was just awful, right? But they were teaching us the fundamental principles of hitting the bullseye every time, because your life could depend on it. Life could depend on it. To sin means to not hit the bullseye. Literally, to sin means to miss the target. The Lord has commanded us in His Word not to sin. You know, you get into Romans chapter 5 and Romans chapter 6, and the Word says, wherever sin doth abound, God's grace doth much more abound. And so then the question comes, well, if that's the case, then what would we need to do? Do we need to sin more so God's grace can more abound? And Paul says, God forbid. You don't understand the nature of sin. Sin is to miss the mark, miss the target, and open yourselves up for failure and loss. The Lord wants you to win. That's why Jesus went to the cross, was so that you could be in health and that you could prosper and that you could be successful. Why do you send your children off to school? Now, honey, here, I've got you an arsenic sandwich. I got a little lye juice for you to drink. And I want you to go down there, and if you live through it, I want you to learn how to fail. Well, no, that's not what you do for your children. You make sure they have carrots. You make sure they have apples. You make sure they have the veggies that they don't like but they need. You make sure that they have something good to eat, not a lot of sweets. You give them something good to drink, not junk juice. And then you send them down there saying, I want you to pay attention to what the instructors are telling you. I want you to learn. I want you to pass. I want you to become successful. Well, that's what the Lord wants for you too. Now, a nation is a collection of individuals. If you have 300 million poor people, you have a poor nation. If you have 300 million prosperous people, happy people, people whose needs are met, you have a wealthy nation. You have a good nation. You have a nation that is walking in the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So if we walk in the way, which is a way to help us prosper, and if we walk in the truth, you'll know the truth, and the truth shall make you free, and then we will have a life that's worth living. I've come so that you might have life, and you might have it more abundantly. You say, well, that sounds like the health and wealth gospel, the grab it and blab it gospel. Well, you've heard the old expression, you don't throw out the baby with the wash that you wash the baby in. And I know that there's people who have taken the faith message and they've gone after it in a selfish way, and they have misused it and taught it wrong. But if you read through the Bible with an open heart, and if you measure the Bible by what the Bible says and not what you've seen in other people's lives, you will realize that nowhere in here did God ever want Israel to fail. Nowhere in here does He want His people to fail. In fact, when Jesus comes and establishes His reign as Lord of Lords and King of Kings, the Bible says that the plower will overtake the reaper. And the thing I get from that is that the earth is going to produce so abundantly that there's not going to be any end to the growing season, and there's not going to be a bunch of children on the face of the earth with bloated stomachs because they don't have anything to eat. There's not going to be, it says, a child will die 100 years old. Length of life is going to be expanded. God's law is going to be implemented. It says that He will rule with a rod of iron. No, you're not doing that anymore. You're going to do it My way. And His way is going to produce good things. Psalm 1 says, they that meditate on the law will be like a tree that's planted by the waters, and in every season it will produce fruit. Even in hard times, there's still going to be fruit there. Now, you and I are the planting of the Lord. We are trees of righteousness. He has planted us beside the still waters of His truth. And as we walk in His ways and do what He said to do, we will hit the mark. And when we hit the mark, we are successful. But it's, you know, like in this county alone, in the last 3 months. How many? I think I mentioned this last week, but just this past week, we had a woman that shot her husband, shot her dogs, and then shot herself. How many people have been drawn into a place of destruction and despair just in our locality? And then we don't really get all upset about it much until it touches us. But this is happening. Why is this happening? Because of sin. Because of sin. You want to play that song, Tom? You ready?
No.
All right, get ready.
Having trouble playing it.
Okay. Sin will debauch you, destroy you, and remove you from the area of success. I like to... Sunday school class today, Sister Glenning taught it, and she brought out where it says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. And that the word destroy means to be placed into a negative situation to where, how was it exactly she said it?
Rendered
useless. Excuse me. There's a lot of people walking around this world that are still alive physically, but they have been rendered useless. Because they have made decisions that have brought them into places of destruction. Now you talk to people and say, well, I guess the stars wasn't lined up right for me. My horoscope said it was going to be bad today. My teachers told me I was not very smart. And you go on and on and on with these excuses. They're excuses. Shirley and I used to sing a little song called Excuses. You know? Excuses, excuses, you hear them every day. Will the devil, he'll supply them if from church you stay away. And it goes on about, got too many excuses, you're just too sick, too down to get to church, but you can go to the ball game.
Amen.
You'll drag your weary body off to work. Too sick to come to church. And so what we want is to get ourselves into a position to where we are not negated in our life and can prosper. Now, let's think about that in terms of Labor Day. Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness of it, the world and they who dwell in it. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the currents and the rivers. The world belongs to who? Well, it belongs to the United States government. Didn't you know that?
No.
The world belongs to God. Now, if you go to Genesis chapter 1, God said, let us make man in our image. And he said, let's give them dominion over all the fish and over all the fowls. And then he gave us a command. In some writings, it's called the dominion mandate. He said, I want you to subdue the earth with all of its vast resources, using them both for the honor and glory of God and man. So there was a command there. Subdue the earth with all of its vast resources. Think about America. When our founding fathers, when our pilgrim fathers and people came here, what was it like? Well, the descriptions say it was just a vast wooded land. Just trees and trees and trees. You can still get a little of that. You take a trip out through the Appalachian Mountains or some of these places, and just as far as you can see, nothing but trees. The only people that can be convinced that the earth is running out of space for people to live in are people who live in cities. Because you take a trip across just the United States of America, and you'll see there are vast, vast areas where there is nothing. We're not running out of land, and we're not running out of places for people to live. It's just that there is an element of individuals within our society today that are trying to convince people of that, because they say that unless you give us control over everything, you're going to just wind up killing yourself. You're going to starve yourself to death. It's not true. Our government is still paying people to not plant. You know that, don't you? You can only plant so much wheat. You got to get permission to plant wheat.
So what we want to do is rein this back to the principles that will make us great individuals and great people again. Think about the fundamentals. Everything has fundamentals. Shooting a rifle, playing golf. Henry did his best. Henry took me out and he really tried to teach me how to play golf. And it was a futile thing. But he was gracious. Josh couldn't quite grasp the fundamentals. You want to shoot a bow and arrow? You can just grab that thing up and just start twanging away. I guess it's called instinctive. And you just start shooting and you can get kind of good that way. But it's only because you begin to develop a system. There's a way to do it. And there's a way not to do it. That's the way it is with everything. Because there is truth. Can we get a hold of that? There is absolute truth that doesn't change. This is the way. Walk ye in it. Well, I don't like that way. I want to do it my way. But your way can lead you to a way of destruction. There is a way that seems right, but it's going to destroy you. We got our young people that they think what they want to do is they want to smoke a little marijuana, want to do a little drugs, have a little party, drink some beer, have a little sexual activity outside of marriage and do all these things and say, well, this is my way. This is the way they're teaching me in school. This is the way. But that's not God's way. That's not God's way. And you say, what is it working? Well, look around you and see if it's working. Kids killing themselves, kids overdosing, kids bringing hurt and pain into their families, into the people that love them. Why? Because they're not walking in the way. There's a way. Sin will destroy. Sin will bring you to a place of uselessness. Now, I want you to think about that. Think about our government. Our government has set up all these programs. Are these programs that the federal government is setting up making people more useful or less useful? Are they encouraging people to work harder or not to work at all? What's going on here? See, because the Word of God says in Proverbs, only in labor is there profit. Government can't profit at anything. Government takes the profit of the laborers and redistributes how it sees fit, and normally it does so in a very wasteful way. See, there's a fundamental. They've discovered that fundamental at Jamestown. They've discovered that fundamental at Plymouth Rock. That we can't just live communal because of the nature of man. What is man's nature? He is a sinner by birth. And unless he is born again, he can't even see the principles of the kingdom of God. And so you're going to set up this system where everybody is going to come and live in communal harmony. Robert Owen tried it in New Harmony, Indiana, back in the 1800s. It lasted a few years. But the old nature of man, you can't just share and share alike. It doesn't work that way, this communal living stuff, because you're going to have people who are living under the old nature that are carnal, they're sinful, they're jealous, they're covetous, they have murder in their hearts, and no matter how hard you try to... See, our founding fathers understood all that. They said the nature of man is sinful. Therefore, he has to be controlled by a system of justice. And that justice has to rest on truth. And the truth can only be discovered in two revelations. One, the laws of nature, and the other one, nature's God, which is found in the Bible. Amen. Divorce yourself from those. You're over here into man's thinking, into man's way. You're over here into humanistic ideas. And those ideas are sinful. They miss the mark and they unleash the curse. Amen. The curse is moving across the length and breadth of this land. And it's got to be up to you and I to begin to stand against it. Stand against it in prayer. Stand against it with our mouths and what we say. And when we see people doing stuff that's just wrong and is destructive, you're paying for it. You're moaning and groaning about the taxes you have to pay well, what you're doing is really trying to offset the course of sin. Because people are sinners and not doing what the Word says, the curse comes in and steals, kills, and destroys. You can't just let little kids go hungry and stuff. So the government says, well, we got to tax you. We got to set up these organizations to do all these different things to get people to do what they should be doing by themselves. It's really pretty simple in mind. I figured it out. And the answer is stop sinning. Do it God's way. Now, the earth and the fullness thereof is His. It belongs to Him. We have been granted the right of stewardship. We're His stewards. Remember when Israel came into the promised land? What did he do? He divided the land up by tribes, and then the tribes divided the land up by individuals. And then those individuals were told, here's your land. Go make a living. There were always systems set up to help the widow, the orphan, the stranger, the foreigner. These were people that were to be helped. You know, because there wasn't any Social Security, there wasn't any of these things. It was there. Actually, Social Security is a spinoff of biblical admonitions to help the widow, to help people who need assistance. And you're always going to have that. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't have a problem with Social Security. You paid for it. And so, as we look at these things, as we follow God's principle, let's take bankruptcy, for instance. Say, ooh, bankruptcy, that's bad. Well, generally, we get into bankruptcy sometimes because of circumstances that's beyond our control, in the sense that things just get dumped on us, we get overwhelmed, and so our government has made, there's nothing illegal about bankruptcy. Our government has made a provision for that because of the year of Jubilee found in the Bible. Every 50 years, every debt was canceled. That means if I, as a sovereign man, do not follow the principles of God, do what He said to do, and I lose everything that was my family's because of my ineptness, that is not going to destroy my son. Because in 50 years, that which was mine is going to revert back to him. Going to be his again. Or be my grandson's. It'll return to my family. That's why you have bankruptcy laws. But now you got people who just use it to swindle. See? But that's really a good principle, to give people second, possibly third chances to get out from under the mistakes, because God wants us to prosper. And our government, almost everything that was in that Constitution, every law that was created at the beginning, was based on some kind of a biblical principle. It came back to a foundation. Now, David said in Psalm 119, how will a young man cleanse his way? How? How will a young person get himself established so that he's going to have a successful life? And then over and over again in Psalm 119, he says, oh, Lord, how I love your word. God, how I love your statutes. How I love your principles. How I love your law. How I love your commandments. I just love those precepts. You know, and you think, I used to read that as a kid and say, what is wrong with this guy? He likes all this law and all these rules and all these regulations. And I didn't understand, didn't comprehend. But you see, David said, I love what you told me to do. Because when I do what you told me to do, then my way prospers. My way succeeds. I come out on top. Let me just give you something simple. The Word of God commands us to bring a tenth of the first fruits of our labors into the house of God. I mean, that's there. You say, well, I don't know. Well, what I found is when you do that, there is a principle. This is a foundational principle. This is a principle. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Now, that doesn't only mean just give to the church. It means give to other people. It says if somebody comes up and asks, give them some. One of the earliest recollections I have is I was probably about 3 years old, and we lived in a house that was close to the railroad tracks. And this would have been 1949. And I can remember there used to be still be a lot of people that rode the railroads. They rode the boxcars and stuff. And I can remember people coming to the door of our home and knocking on the door. My mom would answer, and they would say to her, "Ma'am, do you have anything to eat? Do you have any food?" And I can remember her scurrying through the house, and sometimes she didn't have much to give. Maybe she'd give some crackers and some bread and some peanut butter or something, but she would give. My mom was a giver, and my dad was a giver, and they got given too. And then not only did they get given to, but their son and their daughter got given to because of their faithfulness to give. It's more than just me. You actually bring the blessings of God down upon your children and your children's children when you become obedient to fundamental principles. Now, I'm not trying to say that to condemn you. If you don't tithe, that's between you and God. I don't know who tithes and who doesn't tithe here in this church. I've never looked and never will. That's between you and God. But I know that when you give, I know it comes back to you again. I know that. That's a principle. That's like learning to dribble to play basketball. You've got to dribble. And you've got to do it without looking at the basketball or you'll never be successful at the sport. Fundamental principles that will never change, that will bring blessings upon your life. The Lord owns the earth. He gave it to you and to me to be stewards. Now, let's just put that into modern context. In the state of Oregon, if you own property, you can't cut a tree down without getting permission from the government. Is that right or is that wrong? That's wrong. Because if you wake up some morning and the Holy Spirit says to you, go cut that tree down, you might not even know why. But the Lord spoke to your heart and said, go cut the tree down. The government says you can't cut it down. But the Lord told you to cut it down because he knew that there was a tsunami coming. Or he knew that there was a typhoon coming if you live on the West Coast. That was going to take that tree down, drive it right through the top of your house, and run a limb right through your sleeping body. But the government says, you can do that because that land does not belong to the government. That land belongs to God, and you are his steward. That's why they said no taxation without representation, because you don't own what I have. God owns everything I have, and I am simply his steward, and he alone has the right to tell me what to do with it. Amen. Now, Jesus dealt with taxes. Remember, he sent Peter down to catch that fish that had the gold coin in his mouth to pay the taxes. And he said, render unto Caesar what's Caesar's and under God what's God's. Okay? Well, that's a very big, important point there. You have to give to Caesar what's Caesar's, but you don't have to give to Caesar what's God's. In fact, if you give to Caesar what's God's, you are in dereliction of your duty as a steward of God. So, he said, here is the earth. The fullness of it is mine. I'm giving you a command. I want you to go out there, possess it. I want you to utilize it both for the well-being of mankind and the glory of God. What's that mean? My suit. Okay? So what a nice suit, yeah. Probably this was a barrel of oil at one time. It was either made from oil in the ground or from oil that was made from coal. You say, nah. Yeah. It's polyester. That's where it comes from. That's what it means. To go out and subdue the earth with all of its vast resources. Henry spent a lifetime over tinkering around with chemicals and things for DuPont, and DuPont made all kinds of really nifty things. Really nifty things that DuPont has invented and has blessed the entire world with because they're following through on that commandment. Subdue the earth with all of its vast resources, using them for God and man. So when I work, you might say, well, I'm working for DuPont, or I'm working for this, or I'm working for that. But in reality, you're really working for God. And God has told you, as an employee, you are to work hard every day, give 100%, and you don't just do it when the boss is looking. You don't figure out how much time you can go and hide in the lab and cheat the company out of your time. Now, there's going to be people working alongside of you that will actually get angry with you because you are doing what you're supposed to do, because they are the people hiding in the labs, and you're going to make them look bad because you're producing and they're not. But you produce anyway, because you're doing it to the honor of God. If you're a craftsman, what would that be? I mean, George Glenning, he makes these really beautiful, well, he makes really beautiful everything with wood. Beautiful furniture and things, but he's into bowls right now. And he has put pieces of wood together like a puzzle, and then he puts them on a lathe and turns out those bowls. They are magnificent. The same kind of bowl, if you were to buy it up in Lancaster, probably be $150, $200. They are magnificent, right? Why does he do that? Because he is a craftsman. He has a talent. He has a skill. And he doesn't sell them. He just gives them to people that he loves and blesses, and he's a blessing. And they get given back to him. Give, and it shall be given. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Right above my refrigerator at home. Every time I go to the refrigerator and I open it up, I look in it and I look up, and there is this magnificently painted blue jay that I was given as a gift for doing a wedding. It's a joyous thing that you've got an art and a talent and a skill that you can bring beauty into somebody's life through what you're doing. But it takes labor. It takes work. It takes dedication. It takes getting better. It takes learning new things. See, we have become a nation of entitlement, where people actually think somebody owes them something. No one owes you anything. In fact, Jesus, out of the greatness of his heart, died and purchased you with his own blood so that you could live forever. You should forever be thankful for that, because you have been redeemed from sin and from the curse because of Jesus. And he did that because he loved you. And then all he says back to you is, love me. Love me. If you love me, obey me. Do what I've told you to do. Go and preach the gospel to the whole world. And after people have received it and given their heart and life to the Lord and they're baptized, then teach them to be my disciples. Teach them to do things the way I have told you to do it. Why? Because I want you to prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. I want a nation of justice. I want a nation of peace. I want a nation of people that help one another. I want a nation that is free from greed and covetousness. Covetousness is a horrible sin. Give it the best you got. Share what you have. See, America used to be that way. I got up this morning and I got out my college literature book. I took American literature, and the first is so big. It was two volumes, actually, big. And the first one dealt a lot with the writings of the Pilgrims, the Puritans, the early settlers, and what America was like. And one of the writings was by a gentleman who had been a lieutenant under General Montcalm in the French and Indian War. Montcalm was a French general that saved Quebec for the Canadians, for the French. But after the war, he came down into New York and began to live there, and became a gentleman farmer. And he wrote about what it was that made America so different, so great. And he said it was because it was a nation of small farms. And each farmer worked diligently at his work, took care of his land, took care of his family. And then there was a sense of cooperation. You found that in the frontier. When people would go out, they would do things, they'd work together, they'd make a party out of it. Husking bees, at harvest time with the corn. They'd pick in all the corn, and then they'd go over and they'd husk them. And if anybody got, you know, you planted Indian corn, anybody got a purple one, they got to kiss whoever they wanted to kiss. I mean, it was a fun time. They had quilting bees, house-raising bees, you know, parties. Cooperating, because they had to stick together or they were going to die on the frontier. But yet they were all independent and free. Ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. Now, that can be good and bad. But the spirit of freedom is a spirit that we want to cultivate. My granddad Hamilton was a farmer. Wasn't a big farm. And he plowed his field with a team of horses. And they were, by most standards, probably classified as poor. Didn't have electricity. Didn't have running water. I can remember going out and spending the weekends and stuff with them. And I'd get my Saturday night bath in a galvanized tub, with the water of which had been warmed up on a wood stove in the kitchen. Going to the bathroom was not pleasant. It's an outdoor privy. But you know what? They always ate. They always had something on their back. Because he always worked. And I can remember after they moved to town, he would work for other farmers just putting up fence. That was very difficult work. Because you had to dig the holes with jobbers. You know, these... boom, like that, and dig it out. And he worked very hard. Well, when it came time and he just couldn't work anymore, family said, well, go ahead. You're entitled to some Social Security. Go ahead and take it. He says, I don't want anything from the government. I don't want the government taking care of me. It's my responsibility to take care of myself. It's my responsibility to take care of my family. Now, we live in different times and different world, and I don't think there's wrong in... It's not wrong if you lose your job to collect unemployment. That's not wrong. You paid that. You paid Social Security, you know. But at the same time, we don't want to get to the place where as a people, we just lay down and quit. Because you see, to me, that's sin. Anything that's what was it Garnet said? Renders you useless. If you're an able-bodied individual that can do, and there is a system in place that is rendering you useless, then that has to be sin. And so as we celebrate labor, as we celebrate the work of people who do it to the honor and glory of God, we need to be thankful for people who aren't cheats. We need to be thankful for people who are working on the Lear line, and if their job is to put 5 nuts on a wheel, they don't put 4. We need to be thankful for people who have committed themselves to God, thankful for a land where we can do what we want to do. Now, we're talking about the economy. We're talking about different types of economic systems. Our president wants a different type of economic system than what we have had for the history of this nation. He actually is wanting a socialist system. Now, I took a master's class called Comparative Economic Systems up at Rowan. There's basically 4 kinds. There's feudalism, remember them? That's where the king owned everything and then he parceled it out to his dukes and lords and stuff, and then they had all these serfs around that was chained to the land, feudalism. Then you had capitalism, socialism, I guess there's 5, fascism, and communism. Now, the way you define the differences between them has to do, each one of them has 3 components. I don't want to bore you here, but each one of them has 3 components, land, labor, and capital. And so the difference in those different systems is how the land is used and who owns it, what the labor does and how it gets its job, and then who gets use of the final product and who owns the means of capitalism. All right, here's land. Land is anything that is in nature. water, air, sand, land. Labor is the worker and the work, and capital is anything other than land and labor that is used to produce a good. That would be a lear, machine, truck, shovel, whatever, okay? All right, in a feudalistic society, king owned it all, parceled it out to his lords, maintained power. That was feudalism. People were serfs chained to the land. Under fascism, which was implemented in Nazi Germany, Franco's Spain, Juan Perón's Argentina, in fascism, land was still privately owned. Labor could still work where it wanted to, but the capital of it all was more or less controlled by the government. Even though it was privately owned, the government told capital and told land what it was going to produce and how it was going to be used. Hitler invented the Volkswagen, the little bug, people's car. Okay? That's fascism. You've got a powerful government at the top telling everybody what they're going to make. All right? Socialism, the land is owned by the state. Labor is pretty much controlled as to what it does and where it does it, primarily through the school systems. They do a lot of testing. Tested at, say, fourth grade level, okay, you're going to go this way. Tested again at sixth grade, you're going to go this way. Tested again at eighth grade, you're going to go here, and you have not proven yourself, therefore, you're not going to go on. Everything is free, but the state, through the educational system, controls labor and what you're going to wind up being, whether you're going to be a custodian or whether you're going to be a doctor. See, there's a lot of really bright custodians. My granddad Moore went to the fourth grade. He was the best carpenter in that whole North Missouri area. But he chose to be a carpenter. Okay? That's socialism. Government owns the means of production. Government owns the land. Government tells people what they're going to do and how they're going to do it. And that was Soviet Russia. And that's where we're moving towards in this country. Capitalism is where you as individuals under the authority of God own your property. It's yours. You can do with it whatever you choose to do with it as long as you're not harming someone else with it. You can be whatever you want to be. Makes no difference who your family was or where they came from. You, if you're willing to work and study and you've got it in your heart to do it, you can rise from down here with nothing and go all the way up to the top. Labor does what it chooses to do. And capitalism, the capitalist, the stuff, that's all privately owned too. I can take the resources that are at my disposal, and if I choose to build cars with it, I can do that. If I choose to build homes with it, I can do that. I can use it however I see fit. The government can't tell me what to do with what's mine. And then the last one, communism, has not existed very much. The American Indians were communist because they believed everything was owned in common. If it was the middle of winter and this tribe was hungry and a brave went out and was successful to kill a deer, he didn't just bring it back to the teepee and sneak it away and he stayed fat and good while everybody else in the tribe starved. They had a communal idea. We're going to share this and share it. And in that sense, that's not a bad thing. But it still was his property to do with as he saw fit. Now, what's it going to be? What are the fundamental principles of labor? Only in labor is there profit. Government does not labor. Therefore, the government can't make profit. Only the working guy, only the guy that's taking the vast resources of the earth and in some capacity is being used to make something. We can't ever let that slip away from this nation. because it will be sin. And sin will waste and negate our abilities to be the most productive and the most blessed land in all the world. I did go. I went and saw 2016 last night. And they had pictures of Indonesia, because our president lived in Indonesia for a while, had pictures of Kenya, Nairobi and stuff. And all third world countries are basically the same. The only thing that they can't convey on the television or on the screen is the smell. If you've never, ever been to a third world country, in order for you to appreciate what we have here, you need to go. For years, I've said the senior trip out of this school should be to a third world country. We haven't done it. But I think our kids would come back with such an appreciation for what they have in this country. I can still, sometimes, like when I'm driving down the road in the summer and you happen to have the windows down in the car and somebody happens to be barbecuing and that smell comes through the car window, I'm immediately back in Haiti, because they did all their cooking on little charcoal stoves. But then that smell was mixed with the smell of human waste lying open in the gutters. And it's just a smell that is forever in my mind. Same thing about Vietnam. They used to dispose of the human waste by putting it in half 50-gallon drums, pouring diesel fuel in it, mixing it up, and torching it. And the whole country smelled like that. America smells good. Amen. For the most part, it smells good. And we don't even know to appreciate that. When I got back from Haiti the first time, I felt like getting down on my knees and hugging the toilet and kissing it and saying, "Thank you, God." To have a shower. I was down there, I washed my hair when it rained. I hung my head out the window and put some soap on it and washed it. You say, "Well, why is it that way?" It's that way because of sin. They sold the place to the devil. Toussaint Louverture and his followers sold Haiti to the devil. And the first thing you see when you walk into the airport there is a huge mural of the practice of voodoo, which is worshiping Satan and demons. And Satan and the demons are giving them exactly what they are: poverty, destruction, the curse. We want to become Haiti? Val Costin, missionary here, just when he came here years ago, he just got back from Calcutta, India. He said, "Brother, it was the most terrible place I've ever been in my life." He said, "All day long, the vultures circled the city because of all the dead people laying in the streets that wasn't being picked up." Do we want to become like that? No, that's why people leave there. They leave there to come here to a land that was built on the fundamental principles of God's truth, which caused us to prosper and be in health. Now, we want to become like them? I don't think so. You all can come here, but we're not going to become like what you're coming from. You're coming to a nation built on Christian principles that have caused us to prosper. God has given us witty inventions. He gave us Dr. Jonas Salk, who figured out how to get rid of polio. He has given us different things that has made our life safer and better. We need to celebrate labor. We need to celebrate the good people of this nation who have gone into the factories, gone into the fields, gone into the coal mines, gone into places of hard work. And they did follow through on the command, the dominion mandate. Take the earth with all of its vast resources and use them for God and man. We need to do it with wisdom. We don't want to pollute and plunder. We want to keep the air clean. We want to keep the water safe. But at the same time, whenever you go and use what's here, you're not doing wrong. You're doing right. Doing it according to God's plan. So let's enjoy our hamburger and hot dog tomorrow.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning and his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and I won the victory. Oh, victory in my Jesus, he's my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him. Now all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. When I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. A victory in my Jesus, he's my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him. Now all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. Well, I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. A victory in my Jesus, he's my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Victory beneath the cleansing blood. Oh, I got victory in my Jesus. He's my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him. Now all my love. Thank you.
wrong order.
I got you.
Push me up, because I got this on video.
They got the camera on now.
Well, let's do the camera.
Hey, are you that high in the river? Yeah, I'm tall.
I told him I said I could be really mean right now on them laps.